Good morning. Glad to see you guys this morning. It's a nice sunny day. It's good to be worshiping God. It's good to be here together. I'm glad to see your guys' smiling faces this morning. Just a few announcements this morning before we get started. If you are interested in baptism or membership, just make sure you see Pastor Keith for that. Also, May 6th is the National Day of Prayer. So that's a good thing for you guys to participate in. I know they got something in the works for that, so make sure you stay tuned and be with God on that day, praying for our nation and for our world and for your friends and family. Also, the Unity 66 Pancake Supper is happening on May 8th. We have been getting donations. Thank you, thank you, thank you to those who have been donating. If you are still interested in donating, we still have things that we are in need of. Just make sure you see me first, and I'll let you know what we are still in need of. That is happening on May 8th from 4:30 to 6:30. It's going to be a good breakfast. The youth are going to serve you. It's going to be one of our fundraisers trying to raise money for our Dominican trip. Also, if you are planning on going to CDYC, make sure you have your registration forms into me no later than May 9th. And also, graduation Sunday, the Sunday that we recognize our graduates from high school, that will be on May 23rd this year. Just be aware that there are some children's announcements that they are needing some teachers and different things. And then also, for those of you who are part of the Sunday school meeting, that committee is meeting on May 11th at 7 p.m. That announcement is in the bulletin as well. And that's pretty much all the announcements that I have. Nobody's saying anything, so that must be all the announcements that I have this morning. There's other ones in there. Make sure that you check those as well. Before we go to the Lord in worship, let's go ahead and open with prayer. Lord, thank you for this morning. Thank you for everything that you've given us. Thank you for all the things that you've provided us, the blessings that we've received that we know of, but also those blessings that we have no idea what you've done for us. We thank you for this morning. We thank you for your provision. We thank you for your presence. And most of all, we thank you for your love. We ask this morning that you would hear our praise. We ask that you would hear the worship, and we pray that it would be pleasing as it rises up to you. Be with us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you please stand as we sing, "The Blood Will Never Lose Its Power"? Me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain, it flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. It soothes my doubt and calms my fears, and it dries all my tears. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain, it flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. It reaches to the highest mountain,
valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power.
Seated. This morning, Emily Baker will be coming and presenting us with special music.
Another day come and gone, I do what I hate to do, a little right, a little wrong, it's true. Another choice, another fall, I tell myself to stop, but on my own, it's a war I've lost. Why do I say one thing and then do the opposite? I don't want to stay this way, here and now. I surrender all my life, I take down so selfishly. No more going up and down and up, you take the lead. I don't want to live for me. I don't want to live for me. Give me grace, give me strength. I can't do this alone. Show me when, show me where to go. In the end, I want to stand by your side, no regrets, and give it all to love you like you love me here and now. I surrender all my life, I take this vow, and abandon me tonight. No more going down and up and down so selfishly. No more going up and down and up, you take the lead. I don't want to live for me. I don't want to live for me. To want you like you want me, to know you like you know me, to love you like you love me. I surrender all my life, I take this vow, and abandon me tonight, here and now. I surrender all my life, I take this vow, and abandon me tonight. No more going down and up and down so selfishly. No more going up and down and up, you take the lead. I don't want to live for me. I don't want to live for me.
The children can go to their worship service as we get ready to sing our next song, Lord, I Need You. And the first time I ever heard this song was about 8 years ago. Pastor Dale Hamrick was our worship leader at that time, and you can stand. And my sister Jan Alvarez and I did special music, and we sang this song, and Pastor Dale introduced it to us, and I really liked it. Well, then a few weeks later, my nephew, her son, tragically died. And I hope I can sing today. But I leaned on this song as we went through that time. And so I really enjoyed this song. And I actually was listening to it several times this week in my quiet time as I was preparing for some things that are going on in our family right now. And I was pleased when I saw that we were going to be singing it this morning. So let's sing, Lord, I Need You.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest, and without you, I fall. Christ in me.
praise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need.
Seated.
Morning. I have a couple missions updates for you. If you've noticed in the north foyer there, we're trying to do something with our missions board. It was kind of falling apart and stuff, so we're got something coming soon, working on some plans, so be excited about that. Also, with this whole pandemic, it's been really tough to have our missionaries come and visit us. Some of them have been stuck in their countries. Others have just, you know, been reticent to travel. And so we're finally getting to the point where we're going to start being able to open up more and have some come. So be looking in the announcements. We got some plans coming for some different missionaries to join us. And one of our missionaries who was supposed to come join us last year were Jeff and Shauna Spence. Shauna grew up here in this church, and we got a video from them today to watch to kind of update us on what they've been doing with their ministry in North Asia. So,
when we left the U.S. back in 2006, we had no idea what path life would take. At the time, we were hoping to spend 20 years in Mongolia. 10 years later, in 2017, God directed me to become a regional strategy coordinator with World Partners, which meant a move to Taiwan. Our years in Mongolia were great, and the leaders matured in their faith. It became clear I was no longer physically needed there. Here in Taiwan, I primarily work with Mo Fan Suan Church and Pastor Peter. I have the privilege of leading the youth group and work with a seminary intern. This past summer, because of COVID, I have had extra time, and the youth's normal large camp activities were canceled. So we went ourselves to Taidong and had a 3-day camp. We talked about living out the gospel and were challenged to step out and follow God wherever He leads. We also did an Easter outreach last spring, and I regularly attend the leadership board meetings of the church. Of course, I still attend language school. My Chinese is improving, but reading and writing are still quite a ways off. I meet one-on-one with a teacher about 6 hours a week. Locally, we have partnered with Team Taiwan and work with their missionaries. They provide good support for us, and we meet with several of their missionaries often. It is different living in an area with so many fellow missionaries. Our family is doing well living in Taiwan. Michaela, Ava, and Jeffrey are attending Morrison Academy. Michaela is now enjoying middle school sports, learning classical guitar, and singing in the choir. Ava is in fourth grade. She likes art class and listening to scary stories. Jeffrey is now in second grade. He still enjoys cars, school, and picking on his sisters. Alyssa attends Taiwanese kindergarten. Her Chinese is rather good for a 5-year-old, and she is known throughout our neighborhood. Shauna is working with one of the special needs students at Morrison Academy and likes being back in the classroom. She has also begun teaching the children's church one time a month. Shauna has been able to run several 10Ks and even a half marathon since moving to Taiwan. She has even convinced the two older girls to run with her a few times. The past 2 years have seen a few twists and turns in North Asia. When I picture running the race and throwing off everything that hinders, like the author of Hebrews talks about, I usually picture a flat oval track, or maybe a cross-country race through a golf course. Recently, I'm picturing something like running a maze in the movie Maze Runner, where as soon as you have figured out the path ahead, the walls move and you have to readjust. COVID-19 has thrown up some obstacles for the expansion of North Asia. I have not been able to travel to any new areas. A big Russian Unreached People Group discipleship conference Signa Jaga and I had planned has had to be postponed until the borders open. The race marked out for us was adjusted, but it has not stopped us to continue to invest in relationships and encourage one another. I continue to work with 5 Mongolians weekly. COVID in Mongolia is primarily in Ulaanbaatar, the capital, but this year has also been difficult for herders in Mongolia. Many animals do not have enough fat to keep them warm during the negative 30 degree days. Signet has been able to distribute relief aid to herders this past winter. The local churches have collected funds, along with outside donations, including World Partners, which has allowed the church to be a real, true encouragement and demonstration of the love of God during these difficult times. We are still planning to host a discipleship conference the end of 2021, or more likely, 2022. Jaga and Agi are 2 pastors in Ulaanbaatar. They both work at the Christian radio station. They have planted churches and are now pastoring those churches. Of course, pastoring those churches now looks different with COVID, but discipling others is what Jesus has called us to do. Atka and Bagi are 2 Mongolian women who have recently returned home from China. With the outbreak of COVID, their classes moved to online, and now they are adjusting to life back in Mongolia. These 2 ladies have had their entire lives uprooted and tossed around. In the midst of the unknown, when being questioned by police or visas expiring and not renewed, they have pivoted and continue to serve from a distance. Right now, we are currently only at 86% of our regular pledged support, so we have a need there. To those of you who give regularly, thank you. To those of you who give one-time gifts, thank you very much. For everyone who prays for us, thank you so much. Your prayers and partnership in the gospel help smooth the way, shine a light down the path, or help our attitudes when the path gets adjusted. We are truly blessed to be serving here in North Asia.
We'd like to encourage you to continue to pray for our missionaries, and they face some of the challenges and some different challenges because of the pandemic around the world. This morning, I'd invite you to turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Matthew, chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26, I'd like to read verses 14 through 16. And then we'll turn to Matthew 27, verses 3 through 10. But first, Matthew 26, 14 through 16. Then one of the 12, the one called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and asked, "What are you willing to give me for? What are you willing to give me if I hand him over to you?" So they counted out for him 30 silver coins. From then on, Judas watched for an opportunity to hand him over. And then let's look at chapter 27, verses 3 through 10. When Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned, he was seized with remorse and returned the 30 silver coins, to the chief priests and the elders. "I have sinned," he said, "for I have betrayed innocent blood." "What is that to us?" they replied. "That's your responsibility." So Judas threw the money into the temple and left. Then he went away and hanged himself. The chief priest picked up the coins and said, "It is against the law to put this into the treasury since it is blood money." So they decided to use the money to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. That is why it has been called the Field of Blood to this day. Then what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. They took the 30 silver coins, the price set on him by the people of Israel, and they used them to buy the potter's field, as the Lord commanded me. May the Lord bless his word to our hearts. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for the opportunity that we have to worship together. Thank you for the opportunity we have to read your word. Thank you for the opportunity that we have today to hear from your spirit. And Lord, we pray that we might be receptive. May we have listening ears. May we have eager ears to hear from you. And Lord, we pray that you might guard the words that are spoken and guard the words that are heard. We pray that you might bless us with your presence. Bless us by speaking to us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Over the past several weeks, we've been looking at characters who were eyewitnesses to the events around the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's important that we hear from these eyewitnesses because they are the ones that were actually there, and we depend upon what they tell us because we were not there. I don't think anybody here is over 2,000 years old, right? Probably not. So we take the story, we take the accounts of the individuals who were there at around that time, and we learn from them, and our faith is strengthened. The Bible is an honest, real-life book that accurately spells out the good and the bad, even of its heroes. Abraham deceived the Pharaoh about his wife. Moses killed an Egyptian. David was an adulterer. Thomas was a doubter. Peter was a denier. But these great heroes all failed miserably, but repented and returned to a forgiving God. They went on to live powerful and righteous lives in spite of their failures. We also struggle sometimes. We fail. We can look in our lives and we can say, well, there were times where I failed God. West Missionary Church is not a church of people who are perfect. No reaction. I thought I might get an amen or a, oh, I can't believe it, but I guess not. You know that. But sometimes we come together and we take all of our failures and our difficulties, our struggles, and we hide them from each other. The Bible opens up everything for all to see about great men of faith. West Missionary Church is a bunch of people saved by the grace of God who are walking along life's road together. And we help each other along that road. We pray for each other. We support each other. If you're here this morning, you have expectations that everybody in this room is perfect. You're mistaken. If you're here this morning, you think anybody is perfect in this room, you're mistaken. Only by the grace of God are we what we are, and we still have struggles. Jesus' disciples, if you look at them, you look at how they argued about who is going to be the greatest, you look at the struggles of their faith, you can see that they also were real people. This morning we're going to look at the life of Judas Iscariot, the betrayer of Jesus Christ. His life didn't turn out so well. He did not repent and return to receive forgiveness. Instead, he went out and hanged himself. In John 17, 12, it said that he is referred to as the son of perdition. The son of perdition. Now, if you have, depending on what translation you have, some translations don't use that concept, the son of perdition. Instead, they write out the meaning of the son of perdition, and it means the one doomed to destruction. The son of perdition. Over the last several years, West Missionary Church has been blessed with children. Blessed. And we have the cutest, smartest, lovable, talented children in the world, right? I thought I might get an amen on that one, at least from grandparents. But I've noticed that none of you have named your children Judas. We've had a lot of J names, but not Judas. You see, even over 2,000 years later, there is something about Judas Iscariot that is etched in our minds because of what he did. Son of perdition, the one doomed to eternal destruction, perdition, utter loss. Judas Iscariot and the Antichrist are the only two individuals who are called the son of perdition. The only two. Judas and the Antichrist. So who exactly was Judas Iscariot? It's interesting, he's not only Judas, he's Judas Iscariot. And the name Iscariot is also descriptive, and there's two possibilities that we get from the name Iscariot. First, it could mean that he was a man of Kirioth, located in Moab, which would mean that he was the only one of the disciples that was not a Galilean. It's a little bit different. Different background. Second possibility, the name Iscariot was also assigned to a group of assassins who would carry out assassination using daggers. Which it was, I'm not sure. I would probably lean toward the first, a man of Kirioth. But he was Judas Iscariot. There were other Judases in the Bible. And so, in order to keep this one separate, we find that he is Judas Iscariot. Judas was a disciple or an apostle of Jesus. He was one of the 12. This man who is so evil was also a disciple. He was one of the 12. He's always listed last in the lists of disciples in the Bible. And usually, after it lists his name, it will say the one who betrayed Christ or something similar. Judas was the treasurer of the group. He was the one who carried the money bag. And he would be the one who would pay for things as as Jesus and the disciples went from place to place. So he was trusted. Not, you know, you don't just trust anybody with a money bag. Many think that he was one of the more educated of the 12. So as one of the 12, he saw everything that Jesus did. For approximately 3 years, he would have traveled around with Jesus and he saw what he did. He heard what Jesus taught. He saw the miracles and he heard him teach about the kingdom of God. It wasn't that he didn't have an opportunity. It wasn't that he didn't know about Jesus. It wasn't that he didn't observe the miracles and the wonderful things that Jesus did. he was a part of the group. That means when Jesus sent them out two by two, when he sent them out and said, go, well, you think Judas was included? At the Last Supper, when Jesus washed the disciples' feet, do you think he came to Judas and said, not you? Judas was a disciple, a follower, to a point, of Jesus Christ. So what did Judas Iscariot do? Well, he betrayed Jesus. We all know that. He was a betrayer. He was a traitor. You know, in the United States, there are only two crimes. There are only two crimes which are deemed worthy of capital punishment. One is murder, and the other is a traitor. In the 1950s, I'm not sure if there's been anything since, but in the 1950s, a man and his wife were caught, convicted, and put to death for giving nuclear, well, at that time they would call it atomic secrets, to the Soviets. Traitor. We think of Benedict Arnold. It's another name we associate with traitor. But even more so, Judas. Are you a Judas? I don't know if it means anything to be a traitor anymore, at least in our nation. I think we'd thin out the herd in Washington if we would. Excuse me for that, I couldn't help it. Judas betrayed Jesus. He asked for money from the chief priests. Now, I think about this and I think, how did this all come about? It was pretty obvious that the religious leaders wanted to kill Jesus. So apparently all the disciples would have known this. But Judas, it seems that Judas initiated this contact. Maybe not, but it says that Judas went to the high priest. That he asked for money from the high priest to betray Jesus. And the chief priest said, okay. I'm sure Judas was asking how much. And they counted out 30 pieces of silver. Did you know that 30 pieces of silver was the price of a slave? The respect and the value for who he was, the Son of God, the creator of the universe. The Messiah was sold for 30 pieces of silver. And you might think, well, silver is pretty valuable. kinda, not so much. Not so much in that time. They sometimes say that every man has his price. Judas's price was 30 silver coins. But it makes me kind of wonder, what would our price be? Is there any price? Would we turn away from Jesus for $1 million? That's a small number anymore. How about $1 billion? How about $1 trillion? Would we turn away from Christ for popularity? Would we turn away from Christ to avoid pain and discomfort? Would we say it's not worth it to me anymore? For Judas, it was 30 pieces of silver. We find the character of Judas in regard to money in a situation a little bit prior to the crucifixion of Christ. Mary took a pound of very costly perfume of pure nard. That was very expensive. That was more than 30 pieces of silver. And she anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of her perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of the disciples who was intending to betray him, even then he was intending to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor people?" Now he said this not because he was concerned about the poor, but because he was a thief. And as he had the money box, he used to pilfer what was put into it. If there's the cost of this expensive perfume in there, there was more to steal. A thief. This was not a sudden thing. It was a pattern of behavior. It was a wicked pattern of behavior on Judas's part. He betrayed Jesus. He asked for money from the chief priests. 30 pieces of silver were given him, and he looked for an opportunity to betray Jesus. He planned for Jesus' arrest. This was a premeditated betrayal. It was not a betrayal of passion. Sometimes we talk about murder and we say it was premeditated. In other words, it was planned well ahead of time. Other times, somebody just gets in a terrible heated argument and kills someone. No planning, no previous preparation. Judas Iscariot carefully planned this betrayal. Sometimes we plan things and we decide that's not a good idea. Sometimes an evil thought goes through our head and we say, no, I'm not going to do that. Judas carried out his plan of betrayal. He told him where and when they could find Jesus. The opportunity to betray him came after the Last Supper. And he knew that Jesus was going to go out to the Garden of Gethsemane. So he went and he told the religious leaders, where he was going to be and when. He was an isolated place. It was perfect. An isolated place away from the crowds, because you never know what a crowd's going to do. They might step up and defend Jesus. Or not. But it was an isolated place. And then he identified Jesus by kissing him. This was the cultural greeting of a friend. That's what Judas did. And Jesus looked at him and said, "Judas, will you betray me with a kiss? How low can you go?" And so how did Judas die? We find that he was remorseful. But not repentant. There is a difference. You can be sorry for some of your sins, but still not repent. Have you ever heard of somebody or known somebody that they're sorry, but they're only sorry that they got caught? Repentance means to be sorry enough to quit, to turn around and go the other way. To no longer continue in sin. In his remorse, he went back and he threw the 30 pieces of silver into the temple. And he said, "I've sinned." That's good. That's good. He got that part. And he threw them into the temple. The potter's field was purchased with those 30 pieces of silver. Matthew 27 says, when Judas had betrayed him, saw that he, Jesus, had been condemned, he felt remorse and returned the 30 pieces to the chief priests, saying, "I have sinned, betraying innocent blood." But they said, "What is that to us? See to it yourself." He threw this piece of silver into the temple sanctuary and departed, and he went away, and he did not return to Jesus. He did not return to the other disciples. He went away and hanged himself. The sad, sad story of Judas Iscariot. And you might say, "Pastor, this isn't a very uplifting sermon today. Judas Iscariot. Why him?" Because I think we can always learn from the sins of others. You know, we learn from experience, but we don't have to experience every sin in the book in order to learn to stay away from it. I always try to learn from the mistakes of others, because the consequences of making those same mistakes are very painful. And thus we need to learn from Judas Iscariot. He went out into the field. He went out and he hanged himself, and his bowels gushed out. And he said, "Pastor, did you have to? It's almost lunchtime. Did you have to bring that up?" That only indicates the depths to which he fell and the dishonor that he brought upon himself. The last 2 weeks, we've talked about two disciples who failed miserably. Peter denied Jesus 3 times, and Judas Iscariot betrayed Jesus. Both disciples were filled with remorse and guilt. Peter went on to have a very powerful, powerful ministry. Judas hanged himself. There are times in our lives where we experience guilt because we know we failed, and it weighs heavy upon us. And guilt is an awful thing to bear. If you want to read about guilt, read Psalm 32, read Psalm 51, and see what David experienced following his sin with Bathsheba and against Uriah. But what do we do with our guilt? You know, the thing is that there's a remedy for guilt. And when we come to God and we say, God, I have sinned against you. Will you forgive me? He is faithful and he is just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Instead, many times we wear that guilt, we bear that guilt, we try to carry that guilt. We compare our guilt with the guilt of somebody else and we say, it's not as bad as them. Our guilt should drive us to Jesus instead of driving us away from Jesus. I want you to think back to the Garden of Eden. When Adam and Eve sinned, what did they do? When Jesus came to walk in the garden, in the cool of the garden, as he always did, and they walked together, and what did they do? They hid. They hid. And a lot of times we're so guilty and we're so burdened and we're so embarrassed that we hide ourselves from God. Big, big mistake. There is only forgiveness. There is only restoration. In our Heavenly Father through Christ. And if we run and hide from him, there's no other forgiveness. And so when we fail, and if we have many days left on this earth, it's probably certain that we'll fail in some way. You might say, well, I'm not going to betray Jesus. Well, okay. But could it just be possible that we might sin in other ways? And when we do, remember, don't run away. Run to him. Run to him. Worship team, come and lead us into closing hymn. What a wonderful, wonderful God we have, who has provided a way for us to get rid of our guilt, to receive freedom, to receive forgiveness. This morning as we sing, if you'd like to come and pray, you're always welcome to come and pray. Always, always. This is a house of prayer. If you'd like to come and pray, we invite you to come and pray. Maybe you're not feeling so close to God right now. Maybe there's some guilt that's kind of in the way. Don't run away from him, run to him. If you want others to pray with you, we'll pray with you. If you want to pray by yourself, just tell us to leave me alone. Yeah. Because ultimately it's between ourselves and God. If God's spoken to your heart, to come and pray. And if you want to pray for something else, that's fine too. Sometimes God speaks to us about things totally different than the sermon was on. You come and pray. This is a place of prayer. Please stand together as we sing.
Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and he will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you now. For Jesus shed his precious blood, rich blessings to bestow. Plunge now into the crimson flood that washes white as snow. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you now. Yes, Jesus is the truth, the way that leads you into rest. Believe in him without delay, and you are fully blessed. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you now.
Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you for your mercy and your grace. Thank you for your Holy Spirit who convicts us when we've sinned and draws us back to you. Father, we pray that we might respond very quickly. And Lord, that we might confess and forsake our sins. Lord, help us not to excuse them away or pretend that they're not there. But Lord, we pray that we might be people, real people, that you have called. And then you call us by your name. And Lord, we pray that as we go from this place, we might carry your name well, and we might represent you well. Bless us, we ask, in Jesus' name, amen. May the Lord bless you. The yard is dismissed.